Hello. So thank you for tuning in to our press conference today with Rapporteur Tiemo Walken, ahead of the votes and jury today on the Legislative Initiative Report on the Digital Services Act, adapting commercial and civil commercial law rules for commercial entities operating online. I would just like to remind that today the vote and jury will be on the amendments, and it will take place from 1:45 to 3:45, and the final vote will be on Thursday, and that will take place from noon to 1 o'clock. And I would lastly like to remind our journalists following online that they can, of course, ask questions via Skype, and they can connect to voxbox.ep, write your name and your name of the media, and you will be put in a virtual waiting room where our colleagues will connect you after the rapporteur is finished with his presentation. So after, I will connect you live to the press conference room. Thank you, and the rapporteur can, of course, present.
Good. Then thank you very much, and thank you for the interest in my report on the Digital Services Act. As you know, the DSA will be one of the first big digital policy flagship projects of the European Commission, and we expect the proposal by the Commission at the end of this year. I'm very happy that my report in the Legal Affairs Committee will be voted upon, as you already mentioned, this afternoon. So our compromises cover the complete report, and we will have the final vote on October the 1st. And I'll now take you quickly through the main points of our report. In fact, I have received written confirmation by all groups which have been involved in the compromise, EPP, Renew, GUE, Greens, and my group, of course, that they support the outcome of our negotiations. And I'm therefore confident that we will have a positive outcome in the vote this afternoon. So I would like to take the opportunity first to thank my colleagues for their hard work and our teams on this. The measures proposed in the report can be divided into three main pillars. So the first pillar is protecting fundamental rights online. The second one is measures against disinformation and fake news. And the third one is data protection. Let me start with the first one, protecting fundamental rights online. So far, the way platforms deal with content is based on the provisions of Article 12 to 15 of the e-commerce directive, which determines the liability regime for platforms, and it sets out two main principles. So the first main principle is platforms are exempt from liability for illegal content uploaded by the users as long as they remove this content when they became aware of it. And the second principle is platforms are not to be imposed a general monitoring obligation. So the notice and action system that is already in place derives from these two principles. The problem is that they are that there are no specific rules and how notice and action should look like in practice. Every platform decides for itself how to deal with notifications. The entire system is focused on incentives for platforms to reduce any risks resulting from their liabilities. And this leads to two problems. The first one, private companies are not compelled to avoid liability risks in such a way that also takes into account fundamental rights of users and citizens. If in doubt, a platform is more likely to remove content that may be potentially illegal to keep liability risk as low as possible. By removing content that is not illegal is by far no longer a trivial matter, but grave restrictions of freedom of speech. Especially during this pandemic, we have all realized that online interaction is no longer just a bit of fun, but more and more the main stage of our daily lives. Overblocking is therefore a very, very large risk of freedom of expression online, which results from the current regulation situation. My proposal, therefore, is to codify the notice and action procedure and to set clear procedural standards for how platforms deal with notified content. Instead of just letting them set and letting them deal with liability risks and expect this to lead to sensible content management. In essence, the principle of notice and action remains unchanged, but we give more legal certainty to the platforms and to the step they should take. They must inform users when their content is notified and give them the opportunity to issue a counter notice and be heard. Should a platform still decide to take down content, users must be able to take recourse in front of independent dispute settlement bodies. This is also a new suggestion. There, legal experts will assess the situation and propose a solution. But the final word must always rest with courts and judges. And now let me come to the second pillar, so measures against disinformation and fake news, which is also really important for me. The notice and action procedure I just described should only apply to illegal content. But the question remains, what do we do with harmful but not illegal content? This is also creating problems. So like massive spread of disinformation, conspiracy theories, and so on. The issue here is that we cannot simply declare such content as illegal and ban it, because for better or worse, such content is also protected by the freedom of speech. And still, there is a need for regulatory action to reduce the harm potential. That's why we ask ourselves, what exactly is the problem with such content? Is it the fact that someone expresses such opinions, or rather that these opinions are spread rapidly like wildfire? I think the problem is the latter. And therefore, we must ask ourselves, why is it the case that such harmful content is always more likely to go viral and develop such a high reach in news feeds and recommendations on platforms? I believe this has something to do with the business model of platforms, essentially social media platforms, and nothing but tech giants interact. Essentially social media platforms are nothing but giant interactive billboards. They earn money by showing the users content which they know the users are most likely to click on and engage with, because this is how online ads are sold. This is why the algorithms that sort the timelines and feeds of users tend to favor content that is most attention-seeking. This means that controversial, interesting, scandalous, or otherwise memorable content is rewarded and shown more often to users. This is how filter bubbles are built. And I think one very famous example how it happens, you can follow these in the new Netflix series about the social dilemma of social media platforms. And I want to prevent this. We need to address the business practice of selling personalized targeted ads, and we can do this in two ways. The first one, we give users more control over the criteria according to which content is curated for them, including the option to opt out of curation. That's in the text. Or let third-party services take over the curation of content via an application programming interface. And the suggestion of APIs is also a new idea introduced in the text. The idea is therefore not to censor unwanted content, but to make users less dependent on the algorithms that reward attention-seeking content by increasing the freedom of information online. And this leads me to the last point, the question of data protection, which was also very important for us. Targeted personalized ads require a lot of data gathered by platforms and other services. So they are gathered in personal profiles by constant tracking of users and their behavior and browsing behavior. Contextual advertisement, on the other hand, requires a lot less data. Users will only be shown ads that are related to the content they are currently viewing, regardless of what content they have previously interacted with. This is why the report calls on the Commission to address the business practice of targeted personalized ads. users must be given the choice to opt out of being shown targeted ads, and we restrict transparency measures concerning how the data for this is collected and proposed. This is why we also want to guarantee the anonymous use of online services, including when users use identity verification systems provided by major online platforms on third-party websites. This is also how browsing data is gathered beyond the actual platform environment. So I will finish with a short summary of the most important points. For me, we reached a compromise supported by, as I said, a large group, a large majority of the groups, which was very important for me. The compromise is fair and progressive, so the DSA explicitly should not contain any obligations to employ upload filters or any form of ex-ante control for content. The voluntary use of general, the voluntary use of automated tools by platforms may not lead to ex-ante control of content and should generally be proportionate, justified, and transparent. We also have clearly chosen the path of setting binding procedural rules for notice and action. This is important because, in my view, encouraging voluntary measures only undermines the clarity of procedural rules. We will have effective oversight by a strong European entity, which includes the option of the European agency or a European network of the national authorities, and it has a clearly defined scope for the for checking algorithms and is allowed to impose fines. And then we have the introduction of the independent dispute settlement body, which is also very important. And one last sentence, maybe. Of course, we are respecting existing legislative laws. This was very important for our shadow rapporteurs. So, of course, we have an exemption for the copyright law, which was already decided.
Thank you so much. Thank you. We still have time, but we have some. We don't have a question on Skype yet. Is there any question from the room for the moment? Okay. Maybe not. We can leave maybe one more minute if someone asks something. But for the moment, we don't have questions. So
yeah.
Okay. Do you have any more remarks?
Yeah, I can add a few remarks because in the end I was trying to speed up a little.
No.
So so we have a very ambitioned positioning to the harmful effects of personal advertising, and I really believe that this can make a real difference in the debate about this topic. This and measures on fake news and disinformation constitute a new way to address the issue. Instead of talking about deleting and removing content, we are tackling the economic incentives for these harmful practices. This is supported by NGOs, and we have a clear separation in place between how to deal with illegal content and how to deal with harmful content. And again, I think this can't be said enough. So on the one hand, we have this clearly illegal content, which is dealt with the notice and action system, which is added or which is which becomes better through the addition of the dispute settlement body. And on the other hand, we have this harmful content. And we really do not want to delete content because it's always the question who decides if this content should stay up or should go down. And I really don't want platforms to be the gatekeepers who decide which content is allowed to stay up. So and two more remarks, maybe. The content moderation will have to be carried out by qualified staff. So there is no autonomous decision by algorithms here, which is also very important. And of course, we included the protection of small and medium enterprises and startups.
Thank you so much. I think we have a very good overview of the compromises that will be voted this week. If you actually wish to read the compromises, they're available on the meeting documents website of the European Parliament. And if you have any questions, you can always turn to us by writing. Thank you so much. Thank you. And thank you.
Thank you.